Okay, so now we'll come to some concepts. So what I'm going to talk about here are six principles. Okay, these are principles kind of, you know, it's not like somebody else has given, it's something that, you know, we have synthesized over years of work. But we believe that these principles will be useful for everyone to at least be aware of. Okay, and I'm just going to spend one slide on each principle. It's not like these principles are not like laws. They are like very strong recommendations. They are not sacrosanct, but at the same time, it's highly desirable to follow them. Okay, so let's see what is the first principle. The first principle says curate before you create. What does this mean? This means that there is a lot of great content out there already. Okay, like for example, there is OER Commons, there is Merlot, there is FET simulations. In India, we have NPTEL as a huge repository. We have the Spoken Tutorial project, which is at IIT Bombay. We have the FOSSI project also at IIT Bombay. We have virtual labs at IIT Bombay. A lot of variety of content already exists. So before you dive into creating content, like we are often tempted, right? We feel that, okay, nobody can teach this topic the way I teach. That might be true. But before you dive into it, what is important to keep in mind is the amount of time investment that it will take in order to create your own lectures and so on. So if you can curate the content, if you can find somebody who has done the same topic, what you could do is you could say that, okay, you know, go to this video, watch it from minute 3 to minute 7, and then come back and answer this question. Okay, so that is a very effective way of getting students to work with the content, even if you are curating the content. And many of these open education resources, these projects have been deliberately set up so that we don't have to keep reinventing the wheel. So that's the first principle. Look for content before you jump into creating your own. The second one is keep videos short and insert reflection spot. Okay, so what you see on the left side is something called a learning dialogue. Okay, so this is part of a model which I'll come to later, which I'm not presenting in this talk, but it is part of the course website. So, and one component of the model is called the learning dialogue. So what this means is that you somehow try to simulate a dialogue with the learner. So you talk about something, then you ask a question, you say, okay, you know, here are three options. Which of them do you think is the correct choice? And then you, as an instructor, you know that most students are likely to make this mistake, or most students are likely to think that. So in the content that follows, you can address those conceptions and thereby keep the learner's engagement. Okay, so the second principle is keep videos short. So why should it not be long? That we've already seen. Short videos itself have difficulty in being, in making students watch them. I mean, we are competing with a whole lot of entertainment and all that the moment we go on to the online medium. So it's desirable to keep videos short. It also helps students to identify the sections which they are weak at, or which they want to revise quickly. If we give a long video, a lot of time goes in just scrolling in the video to look for the part where you have said something which that student is looking for. Okay, now how to create these short videos? You have a 1 hour lecture. So the thing to do is to find some natural pause points. Like for example, where I paused earlier and asked, is it making sense? Is a natural pause point of this particular talk. So you can chunk the video at those parts. So a 1 hour lecture often can be broken up into 3 to 4 chunks. And now each chunk becomes what is called a learning dialogue. And within each chunk, what you have to see is there some question that I can ask to the student which keeps this engagement going? So that's the second principle. Keep video short and insert reflection spots. The third one is about practice. Okay, it's about making them do things. So it says give practice opportunity immediately and frequently and give feedback. Now as instructors, we always give practice. Okay, what's the big deal about this principle? The big deal is that the practice is not relegated to the end of the class or to the end of the week. And the student carrying out the practice is not relegated to just before the exam, right? So what we want to do is we want to make the student practice immediately. So you had a lecture, and corresponding to the lecture, you have some assignment or homework or, you know, some problem solving tute sheet or something like that. So the thing to do is to say that, okay, for this component of the lecture, I have a corresponding question, and you give the question immediately after that particular video segment has been watched. So the video segments are called LEDs. I don't want to use the technical terms here. So what could these questions be? They could be MCQs, they could be short answer questions, they could even be subjective questions. You could even get students to grade these questions using rubrics. A lot of things can be done. So I won't get into the details. And a lot of this we will see in the course website as well as in the Moodle course that's coming up. The key point here is the practice has to be given immediate and frequent. And moreover, it's important to give feedback. So what type of feedback is usual? I mean, usually the feedback is says wrong, try again, or it says right, well done. Okay. So that kind of feedback might be okay when you are looking at the student, because then the student can come back and say, okay, why is it wrong? Tell me what is the way to get to the correct answer. Now in the online medium, the student does not have that flexibility or have that mechanism to do that. And even if the mechanism exists, it's a lot cumbersome. So it's important that we build this feedback into the choices that we provide itself. Like the moment the student clicks a wrong option in the multiple choice question, the feedback should say that, oh, look, this is wrong because of such and such reason. And if you do something else, that's the way to get to the correct answer. So that's why this learning by doing, even though we are all very familiar with the idea, it's very important in the online instruction medium. So to quickly summarize this point, take your tute sheet, take your homework exercises, map them to the corresponding segments of the LED videos that you have created, and place them immediately after. Don't place all the exercises away. Give the LED and the corresponding exercise. LED and the corresponding exercise. It doesn't matter which platform. You know, on Moodle you can do this, on IIT Bombay X you can do this, on Bodhitree you can do this, on all platforms. This is possible to structure the course in such a way that the practice comes immediately after the video has been watched. Okay, so if you are still not tired, let me move on to principle number four. Okay, principle number four says provide diverse resources to cater to different students. Okay, so if you look on the left, you know, there's something called a trajectory. So these are called learning extension trajectories. So what is a trajectory? A trajectory is basically a direction of interest. Okay. So like, for example, I may be interested in going into the theory of how communication networks work. Somebody else may be interested in going into, you know, how to actually build large scale networks out in the real world. Okay, a third person may be interested in knowing, okay, what all can be done with these, what are the components that are involved, what all can be done, you know, and how to go deeper into some components. So each of these is a trajectory. Now in a face-to-face class, students who have these different interests can actually come back to you and ask you for references along their trajectory of interest. Okay, in an online class, that is not possible. So it's up to us as instructors to provide for these trajectories. And even within the trajectory, you know, some of them could be videos, some of them could be documents, some of them could be, you know, web links and so on. Right? So this is sort of like the references list that we all, you know, gather and provide to students, and we kind of keep exhorting students to look at that reference, look at that reference, and nobody takes a look at it, right? So the problem is worse in the online setting. So what we have to do in the online setting is we have to incentivize them to access these resources. And the one incentive that always works is a quiz, right? So you say, okay, there'll be a short 5-mark quiz. You have to look at it and you have to choose whichever trajectory of is of interest. You may provide like 3 trajectories and you say to each student, you have to pick one and you choose that trajectory of interest and go ahead. Okay, the 5-mark quiz could be very simple. It could just be just to check whether the student has actually opened that file or not. Okay. And then that actually gets a lot of students to look at these resources. And the moment they look at these resources, a very interesting thing happens. Okay. And that is called peer learning. So the moment students have done something, they start sharing that. They say, okay, are usme that it is written like that, isme it is written like this, and so on. So this is called learner experience interaction. And in the online medium, this is actually one of the most powerful ideas. Even in a classroom, like for example, in IIT, we have classes which are largely homogeneous. But if you go to a MOOC setting, which is a massive open online course, it's a very diverse class, right? So there could be a third year student in your class, as well as there could be somebody who has 15 years of experience working in the industry, who's come for a refresher. So now bringing that industry person's expertise into the course by asking, you know, questions which bring that expertise out is a very big way of helping other students to learn. Now, even in a homogeneous class, let's say in your class, all of them, you're teaching a third year undergraduate class, okay? So even there, what you can do is you can bring in diverse perspectives. So let's say you're talking about some idea. Let me pick some idea. Let's say you're talking about designing something using a software. So now different students will have different ways of designing that. And when you ask focused questions to say, make them share their ways of doing things, then what happens is students learn from each other. And as instructors, you know, that's basically what we are looking for. It really doesn't matter whether they learn from us or from resources or from each other. As long as they're learning, we are happy. Okay? So that's one very big deal about leveraging peer learning. And the other thing that is important here is to avoid isolation issues. You know, it's very easy for students to get isolated when they are online. So there may be that one odd student who is not able to, you know, participate with the rest of it. And very soon that student will get isolated and eventually drop out of the course. So what is important is to have these focus questions and again give some very small incentives to make everybody participate. The incentive could be something as simple as, you know, how many posts did you read? Did you read 3 posts or did you read 30 posts? And it could be something like, okay, what was the key idea that you found in the post that you read? Or what is your key learning from this? And all of these could either be done dynamically as an instructor when you see what the discussion forum posts are, or you could even pre-plan it because you know what kind of responses are likely to come for any question. So that's principle number 5. And then we have principle number 6. So here in this case, you can ignore the figure on the left side. I mean, it's part of the course. I just took the figure. So basically the key point is that we need to respond to students' actions. Again, here, what's important is timely and appropriate, especially with respect to assessments. So whenever students say, okay, what is the deadline for submission? They need to get a quick response because that freezes everything else for them. And appropriate is also important. You know, if you put down somebody in a public and a, you know, written medium, then that person is never going to engage again with that course. So the way we respond to students is also very important. So this response also helps us to augment the course content. Like, for example, you might realize after you've done a quiz that, oh, most of them are struggling. And just as you would do in your face-to-face class, you will go and do an extra lecture on something. Here again, you would adapt the course content, or you would say that, okay, let me drop that advanced topic for this batch and change the course somewhere. So all of these responding to student actions, you know, makes the students feel that, yeah, the instructor is listening to us, and which was something which was easy in the face-to-face class. And we make it happen in the online class through using these discussion forums and the analytics that is generated by the platform. Okay, so now how to operationalize all this? How to make these principles and actually create content? So what we have come up with is called the LCM model. So this is the link and this is how the model looks. I'll just give you a second to look at it. Yeah, so what we have been talking about are lectures. So in this model, lectures actually become learning dialogues. You cut up the lecture into pieces and then you insert reflection spots. Homeworks, assignment, practice problems become learning by doing activities. Additional readings and self-study material that you give become learning extension trajectories. And clarifications and interesting discussions that we do, they become learner experience interactions. So if you have downloaded the PPT version of this talk, you will see that there are several more slides which go into more detail of each of these elements. And you will also see slides which help you construct your own content. So you will see constructors, which are basically scaffolds to help you construct your own LED, your own LXI and so on. So for this talk, I won't go into that level of detail. I'll just quickly summarize it as follows. So your face-to-face course has lecture notes, homeworks and assignments, additional readings, interesting debates and discussions. Okay, so as you would have noted on the previous slide, lecture notes in your corresponding online course now become LEDs. Okay, chunk each lecture into sections and include a reflection spot in each chunk. Homeworks assignment becomes LBDs, or learning by doing. So you chunk each homework into sections corresponding to each LED and include them immediately. Additional readings become LXTs, or learning extension trajectories. The important thing to keep in mind here is to close the loop for the learner. Okay? Otherwise, nobody is going to see the additional readings. I mean, we can give the best simulations and links to the best videos in the world, but no student is going to click on it unless we close the loop by saying that, hey, there is a 5-mark simulation quiz on this. And then there is the debate. So a lot of courses, for example, are discussion oriented. No? I often get this question that, okay, my course is not a conceptual engineering course. Okay, it's a lot of reading and a lot of discussion and debate has to happen. So for such courses, the LXI, or the learner experience interaction, is a good way to make that course effective in the online medium. And let me talk about these proctored exams, right? A lot of people have already asked me about, oh, how do we do assessment and what about exams and so on. Okay, so now the answer to that is it depends upon the technology and the policy. But there is a lot of assessment that can happen through the learning by doing activities itself. So if you see this slide itself, so in learning by doing, you have given a whole bunch of practice questions. In learning extension trajectories, or LXT, you have given a simulation quizzes. And in learner experience interactions, or LXIs, you have given reflection quizzes. So the moment you make these graded, you have taken care of your in-class or in-sem portion of your course. So it's only the proctored exam or the NSEM which we have to still figure out.